Yes.
Okay, we are now live on Facebook. Good evening, everybody, and welcome to today's session. I am Sharma, founder of Carvaan. Today, I have a very special guest, Professor Razayuddin Akil, sir. He teaches medieval and early modern history in the University of Delhi. He has published widely on religious, literary, and historical. He teaches modern, medieval and early modern history in the University of Delhi, and he's published widely on religious, literary, and historical traditions in Sultanate and Mughal India. His books include Sufism, Culture and Politics, Afghan and Islam in Medieval North India, published by Oxford University Press in 2007, The Muslim Question, Understanding Islam and Indian History, published by Penguin in 2017, Lovers of God, Sufism and the Politics of Islam in Medieval India by Manohar in 2017, and Days in the Life of a Sufi, 101 Enchanting Stories of Wisdom, published by Pan Macmillan in 2020, that is his recent book. He has also edited with Partha Chatterjee, History in the Vernacular, published by Permanent Black 2008, which is a great book, a legendary book that everybody must read. And with David Curley, he has written, he has co-edited Literary and Religious Practices in Medieval and Early Modern India, published by Manohar and Routledge in 2016. And with Tilotama Mukherjee, he has written An Earthly Paradise, Trade and Politics and Culture in Early Modern Bengal, published by Manohar and Routledge in 2020. In his lecture today, he will be speaking on the value of the vast corpus of Urdu poetry in the long 18th century, with special reference to the versatile compositions of the popular poet Nazir Akbar Abadi. The lecture will especially focus on works intersecting themes and issues relating to religious traditions and bodily practices, spoken in conjunction with scintillating poetry of Zafar Zattali, Mir Taqi Mir, Mirza Ghalib, and a host of other literary figures. This tradition of Urdu poetry offers significant light on several dimensions of society and culture. The literary practices of these distinguished poets can help us understand the interconnection between literature, culture, and history, even when the poet's literary imagination can go sometime wild. And here's a polite sample from Nazir Akbar Abadi. गर शाल उड़ाई तो उसी शाल में खुश हैं पूरे हैं वही मर्द जो हर हाल में खुश हैं सो बी प्रिपेयर्ड फॉर सम मोर एरोटिक स्टफ टू फॉलो ओवर टू प्रोफेसर रजी सर फॉर टुडेज लेक्चर सो यू हैव टू अनम्यूट योरसेल्फ
थैंक यू ईशान फॉर इनवाइटिंग मी टू स्पीक हियर यू आर डूइंग वंडरफुल वर्क एंड let me straight away get into the problem. Professional history as a discursive field has been threatened by all kinds of challenges thrown at it over the past three decades or more. History has for long been a site for ideological contestations and identity-based assertions. Literary scholars and others interested in the past have also jumped in with their own claims to the production of a social reality with which historians, which the historians wanted to be their exclusive domain, with truth claims and faithful aspirations of telling exactly and officially what happened in the past. This was a somewhat flawed approach, as historians could only say as much as the official sources permitted, and it did not allow much. Happily, things are changing for the better. Historians have realized they can learn from others, anchoring themselves in the history of historical methods and practice. They can fruitfully draw from interdisciplinary research on a wide-ranging themes and issues of common interest. Thus, the critics and opponents of history as a disciplinary practice are no longer being condemned as scoundrels threatening the gates of history with dangerous intentions, as some historians feared during postmodernist challenge, you know, some 30 years back. Historians are not scared of them anymore. In fact, they are now willing to engage with anyone speaking historically and learn from them. Therefore, an exercise here in this lecture is of bringing together literature and history with this caveat that history is also a form of literature, but it's not fiction. It's spoken as a matter of fact based on evidence which can be derived even from imaginative, romantic, and crudely sexy poetry. So therefore, this lecture, as announced, highlights the value of the vast corpus of Urdu poetry in the long 18th century, with a special reference to the versatile compositions of the popular poet Nazir Akbarabadi, 1735-1830. The lecture will especially focus on works in intersecting themes and issues relating to religious traditions and bodily practices identified in particular with matters of spirituality. The literary practices of these distinguished poets, Jafar Zardali, Mir Taqi Mir, Mirza Ghalib, and more prominently for us in this lecture, Nazir Akbarabadi, offers significant light on several dimensions of society and culture in the long period of Mughal decline, beginning in the late 17th century to the middle of the 19th century. The literary practices of these poets can help us understand the interconnection between literature, culture, and history, even when poets' imagination can sometimes go really, really, fantastic. Historians have found this poetry too hot, finding it a bit too sexy. For historians could do sex, but they could not talk about it. We cannot talk about sex. We can do it, but can't talk about it. Because of its association to some degree with Muslim culture, this poetry also tended to be identified with fundamentalism and communalism, sometimes clearly erroneously. Current research on literature and gender in history has created a happy situation for Urdu literature in all its varied dimensions. The focus here is on the celebration of little pleasures of life. It is based on my recent work on the theme. Parts of it is being published in a volume edited by my senior colleague, Professor Seema Bawa, which is titled Locating Pleasure in Indian History, Permitted and Proscribed Desires in Visual and Literary Cultures. It's an interesting collection of essays you should look out for, forthcoming from Bloomsbury in June this year, just less than 2 months from now. And looking at the theme and topics covered in this lecture, as in this book, Who Said History is a Boring Subject? History today is a hot topic, it's political, and what we are doing here is hotter. It's romantic, sensuous, and sometimes explicit. Our public domain should be educated and civilized enough to handle all these with grace, with a cultivated sense of aesthetics. If you don't like to hear crude expletives, polite society recommends shutting up your ears and don't listen to vulgar, you know, conversations. I will warn you during the lecture in advance for any ABCD words in our literary and political traditions. Let me proceed with Nazir Akbarabadi, 1735 to 1830, a fascinating character of Urdu poet who was born and grew up in Delhi, but flourished in Agra, Mathura region, and rose above narrow religious and sectarian boundaries to compose a large number of works in different genres of poetry. His over 900-page Kuliyat are collected works. We can see the cover of the Kuliyat and also those, you know, pages from the Kuliyat now. His over 900-page Kuliyat are collected works published among others by Lucknow's Classic Naval Kishore Press offers significant light on the celebration of little pleasures of life, fairs, fairs, festivals, fresh burst of energy with the season changing for the better, natural bounties such as juicy summer fruits, you know, tarbuz or kharbuza or kakli, some little love as well as chance or opportunity to interact with women in a regressive society, such as in wedding parties, besides other possibilities of fun. Nazir wrote at registers ranging from popular or subaltern level to high poetry of love of the fine ghazal variety. As one of the most popular and respected Urdu poet, Sheikh Wali Muhammad, better known by his pen name, Nazir Akbarabadi, wrote extensively on Indian culture and traditions in the late 18th and early 19th centuries. Though the precocious Nazir was born and brought up in Delhi and much valued as the only surviving child, his family shifted base to Agra, Akbarabad, and hence Akbarabadi, where his maternal grandfather, Nawab Sultan Khan, was once the fort's administrator. Thus, though coming from a politically resourceful background, Nazir steered clear of both the royal court and elite circles of poets and carved out a niche for himself as a prominent and popular Urdu poet. The poet sort of vernacularized himself, deviating from traditional notions of elitist sophistication, identified as adab or adab and sharafat, mingling with people in the marketplace and therefore becoming bazari and melawala and fairs, and writing on themes in local idioms catering to popular interests. Themes and writings which fit in our conventional understanding of what is called syncretism and synthesis in India's cultural traditions and history. Besides large numbers of nazm and poetry in other genres which made Nazir popular, over 600 ghazals attributed to him and his performance in occasional participation in mushairas of poets also meant he was very much known to the fraternity of Urdu poets of his time. And for my discussion here, I'm using a very interesting early biography, a pioneering work on Nazir by Abdul Ghafoor Shehbaz, a book called Zindagani Benazir. Zindagani Benazir. And some of the discussion that will follow is derived, you know, from the majestic history of Urdu literature by the famous scholar Jameel Jalebi. So those who know Urdu can read Urdu. These are the books. So especially Jameel Jalebi's work should be made available in English, multi-volume text. The vibrant cultural capital of the period of 18th and early 19th century Mughal decline, higher education such as higher education or literary practices and performing arts, there were excellence in those fields, should be taken seriously. The entanglement of religious contestations and political churning also complicated the scenario, unleashing new questions of identity, sectarian, ethnic, and even seemingly communal. Just checking, is the voice is okay? You are hearing the voice is okay?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So previous generations of historians had confused weakening Mughal power in this period of 18th and early 19th century of Mughal power and authority with all-round social, moral, and economic degradation. The old-fashioned historians, somewhat old-fashioned historians, not only needed new sets of sources like this material, but also a new framework to look at historical processes in all their vitality, than merely passing moral judgments, which is against the protocols of a historian's craft and method. Take the case of the treatment of Urdu literature. At its height, it is imaginatively romantic, sensual, sensuous, and even pornographic sometimes, which prudish and perhaps homophobic modern historians are not equipped to handle. Not mentioning here to what is referred to as perversion. Just imagine the imaginative thinking on the part of the poet. A Mughal prince is accused by the famous satirist Mir Muhammad Jafar Zatalli, who was killed at the orders of Farrukh Siyar in 1713, of having intercourse with a goat regarding Kambaksh, that he, Kambaksh, used to have sex with a goat besides exploring other possibilities of fun. Historians have tended to ignore the significance of reading the huge body of 18th century Urdu literature on its own terms, condemning it as vulgar and fahish, etc. A refreshing new approach to sources would further strengthen the arguments for cultural effervescence in the 18th century. Even on the question, and there are many examples, even on the question of decline of patronage to artists in Mughal Delhi, literary sources actually reveal a vibrant cultural life detailed in a famous text, in the famous texts like Muraqqai Dehli, you know, of the Dargah Quli Khan, a Persian origin visitor from Deccan. Notwithstanding his political failures, the contemporary Mughal Emperor Muhammad Shah, who ruled from 1719 to 1748, nearly 30 years, a cultural aficionado was nicknamed as Rangila, Muhammad Shah Rangila, certainly deserves a better treatment by historians from what has hitherto been the case. Besides early in the 18th century, the enthusiastic reception of Wali Dakani's widely acclaimed Diwan in Delhi is also a momentous chapter in the history of Urdu literature. Historians should read this Diwan of Wali Dakani. Thus, literary hyperbole of poets who left Delhi for greener pastures, say those migrating from Delhi to Lucknow, should not be taken so literally as Mir Taqi Mir, for instance, and who is a contemporary of senior contemporary of Nazib, who Mir Taqi Mir lived from 1722 to 1810, and Nazib's period is from 1735 to 1830. So Mir Taqi Mir and others desperately tried to convince those who heard him in Lucknow that he belonged to the world-renowned, magnificent city of Delhi, which had just been ruined. So it would appear that actually the city is ruined because there is no patronage to artists and poets like him, of his stature. And in the Musharas in Lucknow, he would be very, very frustrated because they would not know what he is, and therefore, one very interesting couplet that is very, very popular is often quoted. You know, this famous one, kya budobash poocho ho purab ke sakino, humko gareeb jaan ke hasas pukar ke, Delhi jo ek shahar tha alam mein intikhab, hum rehne wale hain usi ujde dayar ke. You know, this is the lamentation of Mir Taqi Mir in Lucknow, and then people would think that maybe Delhi has actually become something of a ruined city now, which was not exactly the case. So let me spend a couple of minutes on Mir Taqi Mir here. With as many as 6 collections of Urdu poetry to his credit, Mir Taqi Mir is widely regarded as the finest exponent of Urdu ghazal. Mir also wrote a collection of verses and 3 prose compositions in Persian, including Zikr-e-Mir, a rare and remarkable autobiographical narrative, which has recently been published with an English translation by C.M. Naeem as part of the very impressive Murthy Classical Library of India series. In this work, the poet offers glimpses into his family background and veritable struggles for survival, both in his native Akbarabad, Agra, and while relocated to Delhi. Interestingly, Nazir saw the reverse trajectory, family shifting base from Delhi for survival in Agra, Mir Taqi Mir from Agra to Delhi. These movements were forced by politically volatile situation in northern India for much of the 18th century, with phases of relative peace in which, and certain locations where, political patronage to poets and intellectuals was possible. The situation had compelled Mir to subsequently fall for the temptations of Lucknow in the middle of the 18th century, where he remained unhappy with an attitude bordering on cynicism and even madness. Like other iconoclastic Urdu poets, Mir Taqi Mir defied all norms, both in his private and professional life. and his non-conformist compositions means no verse. And it is a very, very interesting example couplet often quoted is Mir ke dino mazhab ko ab poochte kyo kya ho unne to. Mir ke dino mazhab ko ab poochte kya ho unne to. Kashka khaycha dair mein baitha kab ka tarak islam kya. Kashka khaycha dair mein baitha kab ka tarak islam kya. You know, Mir has smeared his forehead. He is sitting in a temple and he has abandoned Islam long ago. Why are you inquiring about his religious beliefs, etc.? So Mir's lamentation of the decline in the razzmatazz of the city of Delhi, fantastically mourned in the genre of poetry called Shahr-e-Ashub, which is a very, very interesting genre, is in line with several examples of the frustrations and restlessness expressed by the poets in sufficient lack of patronage. Happily for those with a zaw or carefully cultivated taste for poetry of pathos, melancholy, and loss, Shahr-e-Ashub compositions are one of the best forms of poetry which touches the heart and evokes pain and sorrow. So this is the character of this, this poetry. This is different from the lampooning and condemnation in mazah, hajb, or satire. And one of the finest satire for Delhi, Shahjahanabad, is written by Jafar Zatali. You know, some details I will mention about Jafar. Jafar, who said, Kambaksh used to screw a goat. Now, Jafar is now saying something about Delhi. Jafar Zatali's condemnation of the grand Mughal capital of Shahjahanabad as a veritable Chaupatabad. So think of it. Shahjahanabad has become Chaupatabad. A despicable habitation is a case in point. However, as a matter of fact, even though regional centers vied with Delhi, sometimes aggressively in court cultures and patronage, old Delhi continued to flourish, as it does even now. And one should go and savor the poetry of Kabab at the foot of the Jama Masjid. You know, in the poster for this lecture, you find my profile picture, my picture, and the background is a corner of the basement sitting area of Kareem Singh Jama Masjid, with the wall stained with all the charcoal and masala and rogan, creating a very, very interesting, you know, aromatic experience. So we shall return below to the significance of the writings of other poets from 18th and early 19th century for sort of political and cultural context for a better understanding of Nazir's work. So contextualizing, and that's why this digression into Jafar Zatali and Mir Taqi Mir and Mirza Ghalib subsequently, some bits from Dakkan will also be brought in to show that Nazir Akbarabadi is actually working in a context of the 18th century, you know, and therefore, you know, it's part of the larger cultural practices of the period. Recent researches are also showing that even at the height of the Mughal power, the vernacular literary scene in these parts, whether Urdu or Hindi, was not as impoverished as it was made out by older historians. Older historians were emphasizing on Persian, but now we understand that Hindi and Urdu in these parts was equally important, Hindi in the 17th century and Urdu in the 18th century, particularly expressed in local languages. Regional aspirations were not only being powerfully articulated, but were also making their presence felt at the Mughal court. By the early 17th century, the Braj variant of Hindi, remember, Mughal court is located in the Braj Mandal of Agra and Mathura. So the Braj variant of Hindi came to occupy an influential position, both for its sensuous poetry of love, of the Riti variety, and as a language of scheming court politics. Language of scheming court politics was not necessarily Persian. It could be Hindustani, it could be Hindi, it could be Urdu subsequently. Not surprisingly, despite all the pretensions to Persian sophistication, even the most powerful of the Mughal emperors, such as Akbar, would vent his occasional frustrations by mouthing expletives in Hindi. In a way, the kind of language that we have known here for 600 years in these parts. Those obsessed with Persian in medieval India must read Alison Bush's fine work on classical Hindi literature of the Mughal period. the classical period of Hindi literature is the period of the Mughals, you know, the 17th century, late 16th, 17th century. Certainly by mid 18th century, questions began to be raised on why Mughal dynasty should continue to be in power if it was not able to produce strong and competent rulers anymore. This was a question that was being asked. Some dynamic Mughal officials were touted as more capable ruler material, but for them to come to power meant a revolution. A revolution that did not happen on an all India scale, though regions were getting transformed for better or worse. So Awadh and Bengal and Deccan, you know, Punjab, those parts would be having their own, you know, trajectories, you know, reconfigurations, etc. A drastic change awaited a truly British colonial intervention in the 19th century, 1830s onwards. Before that, we are calling it early modern. 18th century, long 18th century is part of the early modern, which is part of the 16th, 17th, 18th century period. In his Black Hole of Empire, Partho Chatterjee offers one of the finest analysis of mid 18th century struggles and further charting political developments, you know, in the 18th and 19th centuries. Surely not everything was lost in the 18th century, because in the 18th century, we see this kind of material celebrating life is being produced on a massive scale. This was the period before Urdu was reduced to be the language of Muslims in the ghettos. You know, late 19th century, 20th century, Urdu is the language of Muslims, and Urdu is the language of poor Muslims. Even Urdu professors do not teach Urdu to their children. They will send their children to convents and public schools for English medium education, because Urdu padhke kya karoge? You know, Urdu Farsi, you know, loses, you know, its appeal in the 19th, 20th centuries. Happily, Urdu poetry continues to be an important vehicle through which sublime emotions of love and longings are expressed in the best possible form, even now. And therefore, I would say, listen to it from the Refta platforms, for instance. You know, Refta has different kinds of material available, poetry, you know, sung in Hindi script, English script, in Persian Arabic script, and all the Refta festivals, for instance. Despite fear of you know, commercialization, etc., which is a different you know, debate, there have been times and moments in history when men of letters have marked their excellence through extraordinary ways of doing things, such as a Muslim poet composing fascinating Urdu poetry celebrating Hindu festivals of Dashara, Diwali, and Holi in a language that captured the best of the festive emotions. Maybe you can change the slides, perhaps. To show some examples of the kind of material that is available. This is about Kharbuza, and the next one is about Samdhan, and I'll come to Samdhan subsequently. You can slowly move these for some glimpses of the material. Nazir Akbarabadi's celebration of life is best reflected, among other compositions, in his poems on festivals, especially Hindu festive occasions such as auspicious Diwali and hooliganistic Holi. These poems also reveal the poet's narrativization of Hindu beliefs and traditions associated with mythological figures on a scale meant to highlight the excellence of their character and widespread devotion around them as a matter of celebration. And poems such as the one on the birth of Lord Krishna called Janam Kanhaiya Ji, the celebration of events related to his brother Baldev Ji Ka Mela, and on devotion for mother goddess Durga, Durga Ji Ke Darshan, also offer fascinating details from popular Hindu legends. The poems on Diwali reveal not only markets buzzing in preparation, with earthen lamps illuminated everywhere, but also from people going for the broke in the widespread practice of gambling on the occasion, you know, Diwali Eve gambling. For the pious and the innocent, the poet would announce that the lamps were lighted in all the houses and sweet shops were attracting customers. And look at the poetry. This is a different one, but let me read from here. Har ek makaan mein jala phir diya Diwali ka. हर एक मकाम में जला फिर दिया दिवाली का, हर एक तरफ को उजाला हुआ दिवाली का। मिठाइयों की दुकानें लगा के हलवाई, पुकारते हैं कि लाला दिवाली है आई। You know, this is a, and it is a long poem. I just gave a quatrain from here. The poet also reminds the devout that Dashara is celebrated with much gaiety. Diwali is actually a much more auspicious festival. You know, and therefore a very very interesting couplet. Hai Dashare mein bhi yun go farhat o zinat nazir. है दशहरे में भी यूं गो फरहत और जीनत नजीर, पर दिवाली भी अजब पाकीजा तर त्यौहार है, पर दिवाली भी अजब पाकीजा तर त्यौहार है। The endless possibilities of thoughtful amusement is specially, and there is a holy thing mentioned here on the screen. The endless possibility of thoughtful amusement is specially narrated by Nazir Akbar Abadi in several compositions on Holi. When the participants are physically charged for amorous advances, taking advantage of the refrain later pronounced in Hindi as "Bura na mano holi hai," "Bura na mano holi hai." In fact, Nazir here has also written "Holi hai holi," you know, and then the crowd will come and splash colors all over. Here is a polite sample of musical instruments to announce the arrival of holi playing groups. And friends and lovers gleefully showering each other with colorful gestures. One or two line I can see on the screen also. Mirdange baje taal baje kuch khanak khanak kuch dhanak dhanak. Mirdange baje taal baje kuch khanak khanak kuch dhanak dhanak. Jab khuba aaye rang bhare phir kya kya holi jhamak uthi. जब खूबा आए रंग भरे फिर क्या क्या होली झमक उठी, कुछ हुस्न की झमके नाज भरे, कुछ शोखी नाज अदाओं की, कुछ हुस्न की झमके नाज भरे, कुछ शोखी नाज अदाओं की। सब चाहने वाले गिर्द खड़े नजारा करते हंसी खुशी, महबूब भिगोए आशिक को और आशिक हंसकर उनको भी। This is a long poem and I just presented some bits from here, and some compositions of Nazir are truly meant to fit straight into the classical Hindustani music, capturing the pleasant mood of the festive season with a veritable thrill in the air. Maybe another page has a sample here, and it sounds like this. Jab phagun rang jhamakte ho tab dekh bahare holi ki, jab phagun rang jhamakte ho tab dekh bahare holi ki, और दफ के शोर खड़कते हो तब देख बहारे होली की। जब दफ और दफ के शोर खड़कते हो तब देख बहारे होली की। दो नजीर अबराबादी एंड हिज पेट्रंस ऑन हुज रिक्वेस्ट ही वुड कंपोज एक्सटेम्पोर पोएट्री सीम पर्टिकुलरली इंटरेस्टेड इन एंडलेस पॉसिबिलिटीज ऑफ फन ड्यूरिंग होली ऑन विच सेवरल पोएम्स वर रिटन बाय हिम एंड रिकॉर्डेड इन हिज कुलियात द पोएट्स वर्क ऑन फेस्टिवल्स सच एज ईद इज इक्वली इंटरेस्टिंग. And there was an Eid, there is a page on Eid and Shab-e-Barat also here. After sketching quite a realistic picture of Shab-e-Barat as a special night devoted to prayers in traditional Muslim calendar, marked by both pietistic veneration for the dead and Diwali-like fireworks and lighting all around. This is Budhape Ka Ishq, which will come later. Nazir records the celebration of Eid, beginning with early morning bathing, wearing brand new clothes, going to Eidgah for congregational prayers, meeting people and offering hugs, and savoring special delicacies and sweetmeats such as mouth-watering sevaiyan. These are the features of Eid. Nazir writes on Eid and practice of offering hugs, saying Eid Mubarak, and pleasures accrued from the festive emotions. And the line is very, very interesting. It's there on the screen also. And aisi na shabe barat na bakrid ki khushi, aisi na shabe barat na bakrid ki khushi, jaisi har ek dil mein hai is Eid ki khushi, jaisi har ek dil mein hai is Eid ki khushi. And the questions here are equally interesting. Just two examples. Pichle pahar se utke nahane ki dhoom hai. पिछले पहर से उठ के नहाने की धूम है, शीरो शकर सेवैया पकाने की धूम है, शीरो शकर सेवैया पकाने की धूम है, पीरो जवां को नेमतें खाने की धूम है, पीरो जवां के को नेमतें खाने की धूम है, लड़कों को ईदगाह के जाने की धूम है, लड़कों को ईदगाह के जाने की धूम है। एंड अदर लाइंस, महबूब दिलबरों से है जिनकी लगी लगन, यू नो लवर्स आल्सो वांट टू मीट ऑन ईद एंड गले मिलो, महबूब दिलबरों से है जिनकी लगी लगन, उनके गले से आन लगा है जो गुल बदन, सौ सौ तरह के चाह से मिल मिल के तन से तन, कहते हैं हमको ईद मुबारक, कहते हैं तुमको ईद मुबारक हो जाने मन, सौ सौ तरह के चाह से मिल मिल के तन से तन, कहते हैं तुमको ईद मुबारक हो जाने मन। अनदर पोएम on Eidgah Agrabad, the Eidgah of Agra typically sums up the mosque celebrations in the overflowing Eidgah premises, with the crowd lining up in the adjacent gardens and vacant places and roads choked a block. Kya kya maze hain Eid ke aaj Eidgah mein, kya kya maze hain Eid ke aaj Eidgah mein is a refrain. Aate hain ghar se apne jo ban ban ke kuch kula, you know, tirchi topi wale, आते हैं घर से अपने जो बन बन के कुछ कुला, छाती से लिपटे जाते हैं हंस हंस के खामखा, छाती से लिपटे जाते हैं हंस हंस के खामखा, हाथी व घोड़े बैलो रथ व ऊंट की कतार, दीज आर दी व्हीकल्स, हाथी व घोड़े बैलो रथ व ऊंट की कतार, गुल शोर बाले भोले खिलौने की है पुकार, खिलौने वाला मेला लगाए हुए हैं। And this line is very, very interesting. Kamre, kamar, kamre, sabhone milne ki khatir hai kasliyan, kamar kasliya hai. Kamre, sabhone milne ki khatir hai kasliyan, milte hain yun ke chhati ki kadke hain pasliyan, milte hain yun ke chhati ki kadke hain pasliyan. And much of it was certainly possible because Nazir Akbar Abadi grew up in Delhi at a time of cultural effervescence, actively promoted by later Mughal emperors, especially, as I said, Muhammad Shah Rangila, the colorful, even as political power and authority was being continuously shaken by invaders from the northwest. Within a 30-year period, we have Nadir Shah and Ahmad Shah Durrani ransacking large parts of northern India, including Delhi, you know, in 1730-1760 period. Within the circle of eminent Urdu poets, Nazir's life and career overlapped between two stalwarts, Mir Taqi Mir and Mirza Abdullah Khan Ghalib's. Ghalib's period is 1797-1869. And remember, you know, Nazir Agrabadi is alive till 1830. So when Nazir is, when Ghalib is 33-year-old, Nazir is still around. So there were interactions with, you know, fruitful interactions across generations. Young Nazir received rare appreciation from another otherwise arrogant and veteran Mir Taqi Mir. Mir Taqi Mir will not give bow to any other poet, but he inquired, who is this Nazir Akbar Abadi? And as a senior and popular poet, Nazir heard the rising fame of Mirza Ghalib. Some would say that maybe Mirza Ghalib, you know, learned from Nazir Akbar Abadi, you know, in Agra, but we don't have, you know, that kind of evidence for us. So let me quickly give a couple of examples from Ghalib and his significance before we proceed further back to Nazir's sample. Some 2000 Urdu poets, Ashar of Mirza Ghalib, even if not literally understood, warm up the inner chord of even a heartless crow. They recite this in political assemblies even now, you know, Ghalib's poetry. And look at this fine articulation of heartache. Even if not literally understood, but people will understand the emotions involved in the writing and recitations of such said poetry. This is Ghalib. Dil mera soze niha se be muhaba jal gaya. दिल मेरा सोजे निहां से बेमुहाबा जल गया, आतिशे खामोश की मानिन गोया जल गया, आतिशे खामोश की मानिंद गोया जल गया, दिल में जौके वस्ल व यादे यार तक बाकी नहीं, दिल में जौके वस्ल व यादे यार तक बाकी नहीं, आग इस घर में लगी ऐसी के जो था जल गया, आग आग इस घर में लगी ऐसी के जो था जल गया. Thus, Urdu poetry defies regressive social norms and invokes natural justice, often in the name of Mirza Ghalib, who arguably epitomizes the best this literary tradition has to offer. Many others excelled in this art form for over three centuries, 18, 19, 20th, and will continue to flourish. Even though the last Mughal poet, Ghalib, pleaded simplicity and austerity, which could be cross-checked on his death. And what did one very interesting poetry, some of you have already heard it. Chand tasveere butan, chand haseeno ke khatoot. Chand tasveere butan, chand haseeno ke khatoot. Baad marne ke mere ghar se ye sama nikla. And we know Ghalib did a lot of buttering to the British without success. And earlier, Mir Taqi Mir had suspected the gritty greed of the British people, loot and plunder, and steered clear of them. Mir Taqi Mir did not want to meet in Lucknow Hastings, saying, what is the point in meeting these people? They have no idea of my language, and they have no respect for my khandan also. And the life has become Angrez ka zindan, the jail of the British people. So together, these poets and their numerous contemporaries excelled in their literary practice, which was central to their lives in their own distinct ways. Nazir is often not counted in the history of classical Urdu literature because of the way he catered to the popular taste in his compositions. His celebration of Hindu religious practices, traditions, myths, and legends needs serious consideration, especially in times when Hindi, Urdu, and Hindu-Muslim divide and conflict serve as fodder for those who thrive on religious communalism. Returning to his own time and compositions, Nazir Akbar Abadi wrote as tough few could dare, yet they received wide public circulation and appreciation in 18th and early 19th century Delhi, Agra, and Mathura, apart from other areas. Prudish later generations also read his work, mostly in private, and scholars of Urdu literature maintain study ambiguity. Nazir is, or Jafar Zardali, they are vulgar. How do we study them? How can we teach them to our students? Though several compositions of Nazir were published in poetic collections of different kinds, the conservative and traditional milieu of Urdu reading public might have been embarrassed by the kind of work Nazir produced. It could be called, easily called, it's a bazaari, besides being vulgar, fahish. However, there is an older history of this ambiguity, which may be referred here briefly. The hierarchical, prudish, and patriarchal societies seek to discriminate, marginalize, and suppress what they perceive as abnormal through a violent process of othering. And in doing so, they resort to religious justification of their actions, for which there may be absolutely no legal grounds, as in archaic law criminalizing homosexuality. And homosexuality is a theme, referred to in Urdu poetry. Homosexuality is considered abnormal in conservative circles because the homophobic society thinks so. And families and societies use religion for justification of their norms to control things. Thus, lives and bodies of people are minoritized and criminalized. Indeed, literature and history offer a window to peep in the long struggle involving sex for pleasure and sex for reproduction. The iconoclastic Urdu literature offers some of the finest articulation and celebration of a variety of ways in which sexual pleasure was possible, whether hidden in private or in public, and despite attempts to suppress what is termed as perversion. You remember I was mentioning about Jafar Zardali's Kuliyat offering very, very fantastic observations on the on the conduct of the Mughal princes. The fine work, and this I have discussed in some detail in a chapter of my book, Penguin Book on Islam. The fine work on Rehti, you know, Rehti. The fine work of Rehti by Karla Petrovich and Ruth Vanita on men masquerading as women and sharing things the latter were not expected to do in the polite and hypocritical society is also relevant. Women, they are not supposed to be speaking about their personal experiences in public. Ghar ki baat ko bahar kyun bologi? One of the foremost authorities of historical Urdu literature, C.M. Naeem's interesting early work on transvestite and rehti poems in Urdu is equally significant. And I will quickly give a couple of very, very interesting examples, a couple of examples from Naeem's work on the Urdu text. An interesting example of rehti, feminine form of early Urdu poetry, rehta. Remember, rehta ladka hai, rehti ladki hai. Rehti, narrativizing matters of love, often multisexual, and a whole lot of other concerns may be mentioned here. The poet Nisar Hussain Khan Shaida, who is a late person, late 19th century, spoke in gendered terms, giving voice to a woman's concerns, you know, inside the house, you know, domestic politics, struggles within with in-laws for dominance in the domestic space. And I don't know whether people have read or noticed, this is fantastic. And only a poet can imagine like this, you know. Women feel, but they don't say this because they are a polite people. But a poet giving voice to a woman's concern and pain can write this in public, you know, in Mushaira and expose the hypocrisies in the society. It is somewhat vulgar, but it is still, you know, we are mature enough to listen to this. The woman is singing, Susral mein jo paadun, to maike mein ho khabar. ससुराल में जो पादू तो मैके में हो खबर एक इश्तिहार नंद है एक इश्तिहार सास एक इश्तिहार नंद है एक इश्तिहार सास. Indeed, words are deployed as weapons in classical Urdu poetry at its zenith. Not for nothing, one of the noted exponents of Rehti, Saadat Yar Khan Rangin, who is also an 18th century figure, poet, born 1755, so younger contemporary of Nazir, preferred to call his work female angehta. So rehta is a poetry being written for men by men. Angehta is a female response, you know, to rehta. And angehta means aroused, erect. As a response to male rehta, it means the fallen one. Rehta is the fallen one. So mostly written by men doing masti or fun in feminine voice, the above rehti couplet, you know, Ek Ishtihar Nand Hai, Ek Ishtihar Saas by Nisar Hussain Khan Shaida is quoted by C.M. Naeem in his collection of essays called Urdu Texts and Contexts. And some of the chapters in this book is very, very interesting. I will come to Budhape Ka Ishq and Moti and Sandan shortly. Reading these and the following might disorient or reorient and reconstruct those who take themselves for granted. These cultural narratives are not only significant for their entertainment value, for fantastic articulation on love and sex, but also for understanding the value of words as important weapons in the poetry of protest. It required a lot of guts to write the way the poets did. You know, in the late 17th century, early 18th century, Jafar Zaghali daringly composes a poem called An Account of a Catamite, you know, Gandu Nama, and this is a vulgar expression, considered to be a vulgar expression now. And he wrote it for Bahadur Shah. You know, Bahadur Shah was the successor of Aurangzeb. After Aurangzeb, Bahadur Shah, you know, his son, 1707, 1712, he would say that basically saying Bahadur Shah is a catamite. Badshahi hai Bahadur Shah ki, band banakar A B C D kheliye. You know, is what the poetry is considered to be vulgar in our language and time now. Zaghali's satire on Aurangzeb's youngest son I mentioned already, and Zaghali was eventually killed by the orders of Emperor Farrukhsia. Farrukhsia subsequently, after Bahadur Shah, ruled 1713 to 19, for calling him, as a matter of fact, a leather belt executioner. You know, if Farrukhsia would not agree with someone and is angry, he would just throttle using a leather belt, you know, to the person. And this is the treatment meted out to Jafar Zatali also. So Mughal authority was not entirely lost yet, but surely this kind of literature was impossible under Akbar and Jahangir, and even under Shah Jahan and Aurangzeb. No one could dare write the kind of poetry these people have subsequently written for later Mughals. Together, we know these four rulers saw off 150 years of Indian history, you know, from the middle of the 16th century to late in the 17th, early 18th century. Eventually, times were changing, and some dared to raise questions on legitimacy of those in power and authority, later Mughals, post-Aurangzeb. So continuing in the tradition of iconoclastic Urdu literature, Nazir wrote a poem, and we are now getting into the body part of it. So Samdhan and Moti and Budhape Ka Ish and Jawani, you know, Jawani, Joban, Joban Ke Rang. Nazir wrote a poem which in times of political flux and moral policing might sound like sexual harassment or sexist remarks of an old wretch who seeks to take advantage of getting close to a woman who is going to be the mother-in-law of his child, and thus a Samdhan. And sample this composition on Samdhan. This is about her body parts and other features. And this is fantastic, but I will just quickly present two or three couplets from here and move on. Listen to this language. Karun kis muh se ae yaaron, bayaan mein shaan samdhan ki. Karun kis muh se ae yaaron, bayaan mein shaan samdhan ki. Lagi hai ab to mere dil ko pyari aan samdhan ki. Lagi hai ab to mere dil ko pyari aan samdhan ki. चमन में हुस्न के हूँ उसके रुख और जुल्फ पर कुर्बान, अगर देखें जरा सूरत गुलो रेहान समधन की. एंड द नेक्स्ट कपलेट इज इक्वल इंटरेस्टिंग. कमर नाजुक मटकती चाल आंखें शोक तन गोरा, नजर चंचल अदा अचपल यह पहचान समधन की. सुनहरी ताश का लहंगा रुपहली गोट की अंगिया, चमकता हुस्न जोबन का झमकती आंच Samdhan ki. And then it's becoming very, very erotic. I do not know whether it is allowed on Facebook, live, but I will stop with one couplet maybe. Malai sa shikam, sina musaffa, khushnuma saqein, safa zanu ka aina, mulayim ran samdhan ki. Kahun kuch aur bhi aage, jo samdhan hukm farma dein, सिफत मंजूर है हमको तो अब हर आन समधन की. The further lines are becoming very, very erotic, so I'm skipping here. This is clearly a wicked, wicked poem. Nazir could not have been naughtier, yet head-to-toe description of the perfection of the female body is an established trope in Nazir's poetry, as in classical Indian aesthetics, on bodily features and practices. So there's a long history of talking about the beauty of the female body from head to toe. In the above poem, he begins describing the beauty of the woman with her face, rukh, and hair, zulf, pitted against the flowers in the garden, the clean chest, slim waist, creamy belly, tender thighs, or the well-groomed woman is a scintillating presence, completed by the naughty eyes, playful gaze, and dalliance in movement with a pair of lovely legs, and the body as a whole, sensuously fair. This is the description by Nazir of the Samdhan. Indians are a racist people, especially when celebrating the female body, which should be fair and lovely, to the extent that when the woman sits, her knees are so clean, they shine like a mirror, with a mannerism that is puffed with pride, that is further lifted by elegance personified. So in some women should be pretty lovely, man can be awfully ugly. You know, if you don't agree with me, then you can ask Mukul Keswan, who wrote this very interesting essay on the ugly Indian male and other propositions. So Nazir develops beautiful female attributes further in the poem on his beloved, previously preciously named Moti or Pearls, which is here on the screen also, another another slide. The composition Moti is truly, truly flattering. Know this, one of the early slides has the Moti, Moti one. Maybe you can move further, perhaps you can see. Yeah, this is one. And two, three lines, this is the poem, and two, three lines I quickly present for those of you who do not read this script. Parizado, what will understand? Parizado mein hai naam khuda jis shaan par moti. कोई ऐसा नहीं मोती मगर मोती मगर मोती और झमक जावे निगाहों में जवाहिर खाने कुदरत जो खाकर पान और मलकर मिस्सी हंस दे अगर मोती रगे गुल उस कमर के सामने भरती फिरे पानी लचक में और नजाकत में जो रखती है कमर मोती लचक में और नजाकत में जो रखती है कमर मोती उधर हर एक मकां पर मोतियों के ढेर हो जावें अदा से नाज से हंसकर कदम रखे जिधर मोती और सदा सुनकर हर एक चश्म से मोती टपकते हैं फकत बैठे ही गाने में ये रखती है असर मोती अजब नक्शा अजब सजधज अजब आंखें अजब नजरें बड़े ताले बड़ी किस्मत जो देखे एक नजर मोती और हर एक दंदान मोती हुस्न मोती नाम भी मोती सरापा चश्म मोती तस्पे पहने सर बसर मोती और जो खूबान बेनजीर इस दौर में है नाजुक और रंगीन शर्फ रखती है यारो अब तो सबके हुस्न पर मोती सो Quickly summarizing, Nazir has once again emphasized on the fineness of the woman's body. West has lachak, suppleness, and nazakat, elegance, wonderful features enhanced by captivating gaze and pearls or moti-like teeth. The poet has also highlighted the emotions generated by her laughter and overwhelming quality of her voice, which may cause pearls or moti-like tears. Both the features of the body and emotions are doubly enhanced by her embellishments and makeup using paan and missi. Missi is a herbal concoction with sexual connotation applied by women on their teeth during wedding ceremonies, as well as finely designed dress and accoutrement. All these would give shape to a particular ada and naaz, grace and pride, and a perfect profile, naksha. Nazir provokes and challenges other exceptionally good-looking, slim, and colorful women by claiming that his moti is superior to all other pretty women of the time. Sharf rakhti hai yaro, ab to sabke husn par moti. You know, is a claim he's making. So Nazir's real-life beloved, you know, partner or girlfriend, Mashuka, Moti might have been may have been mighty pleased by the exaggerated praise heaped on her, and there is nothing sexist about it. There is nothing sexist about this praise for Moti. A well-groomed and chiseled body with an awe-inspiring style, mannerism, or ada could be a deadly combination for connoisseur of love, producing a variety of complicated emotions, which have all been summed up by Nazir in his long poem called Lutf-e-Shabab, which is equally also very, very interesting. I think one slide has some parts from Lutf-e-Shabab also. Jawani, you know, Jawani ka Lutf. It is a very long, four pages, so I'll just present four couplets from here. Kya aish ki rakhti hai sab ahang jawani. Kya aish ki rakhti hai sab ahang jawani. Karti hai baharon ke tain dang jawani. Har aan pilati hai main aur bang jawani. Karti hai kahin sulh hai. कहीं जंग जवानी करती है कहीं सुलह कहीं जंग जवानी इस ढब के मजे रखती है और ढंग जवानी आशिक को दिखाती है अजब रंग जवानी several of them I'm just skipping this is long poem but let me present चेहरे पे जवानी का जो आकर है चढ़ा नूर चढ़े चेहरे पे जवानी का जो आकर है चढ़ा नूर रह जाती हैं परियां भी गर्ज उसके तई घूर छाती से लिपटती है कोई हुस्न की मगरूर, गोदी में पड़ी लोटे है चंचल सी कोई हूर, गोदी में पड़ी लोटे है चंचल सी कोई हूर, हंस हंस के कोई हुस्न की छलबल है दिखाती, मिस्सी कोई सुरमा कोई काजल है दिखाती, चितवन की लगावट कोई चंचल है दिखाती, कुर्ती कोई अंगिया कोई आंचल है दिखाती। एंड क्या तुझसे नजीर अब मैं जवानी की कहूं बात, इस पन में गुजरती है जब ऐश से औकात, महबूब परिजात चले आते हैं दिन रात, सहरे हैं बहारे हैं तबाजो है मदारात। So this is a long poem, 4 pages in my printout here, but I kept it short. Also because, you know, in our modern times, we cannot speak in this language perhaps because there is so much restrictions on expressions of emotions of these kinds. The poem clearly sums up the strength of youth and celebration of life attached to it and associated pleasures. As the refrain said, is dhab ke maze rakhti hai aur dhang jawani, expose youthful lovers with all kinds of fantastic possibilities. Aashiq ko dikhati hai ajab rang jawani. And some of the references are sexually explicit. Angiya ke tain cheer ko kurti ko liya phaad. Angiya ke tain cheer ko kurti ko liya phaad. And some encounters are euphemistically explained as attractions of love. Kurti koi angiya koi aanchal hai dikhati. The poetic expressions of sense of loss in the poem, by contrast, on old age helplessness, are no less fantastic. So this was youth and then the old age helplessness. I think there is a slide on this, budhape ka isht, on alame, it has some bits from here. There's another one, but this one is on budhape ka isht. सब चीज को होता है बुरा हाय बुढ़ापा, सब चीज को होता है बुरा हाय बुढ़ापा, आशिक को तो अल्लाह न दिखलाए बुढ़ापा, आशिक को तो अल्लाह न दिखलाए बुढ़ापा। The poet compares a change in attitude towards the old man faced with utter neglect with the older youthful time when one was much in demand. So one, the same person, when that person becomes old, no one, you know, takes care of that person. You know, it's okay. You become old now, you should withdraw. Aage the jahan gulbadan aur yusuf-e-sani, yusuf, you know, yusuf-e-sani, dete the hame pyar se chhallon ki nishani, mar jaye to ab muh mein na dale koi pani, mar jaye to ab muh mein na dale koi pani, kis dukh mein hame chhod gayi hai jawani, kis dukh mein hame chhod gayi hai jawani. Interestingly, some lovelorn old men do not give up easily. They still try, you know, old men. So Nazir offers a thoroughly imaginative dialogue between powers of youth and value of lifelong experience. And therefore the old man will say, our experience is better than your power. The old man challenges and provokes. The young is nothing before us, he would say. Ab bhi hamare aage yaro jawan kya hai? It will be the refrain. Ab bhi hamare aage yaro jawan kya hai? And the poet elaborates on behalf of the old man's claims of expires. Hum kya kya kar sakte hain? Karte hain hum jo yaro ab dhoom aur dhadke. Karte hain hum jo yaro ab dhoom aur dhadke. Dekhe jawan to uske chhut jaye dam mein chhakke. Dekhe jawan to uske chhut jaye dam mein chhakke. And the imaginative challenge continues in this interesting formulation of the contrast between the youth and the old in risking being caught in attempting to meet their respective beloved. While the youth can escape jumping from the wall, and look at the claim, the youth can escape jumping from the wall, the old man might hop across the rooftops. Wo gar diwal kude hum kotha phan jame. Wo gar diwal kude hum kotha phan jame. And the lines are, hum aur jawan milkar gar dil ke tai lagave. और अपने अपने गुल से मिलने के दिल में लावें, जाकर उन्हों के घर पर जब जोर आजमावें, वो घर दीवाल कूदें हम कोठा फान जावें। The old man also claims it did not matter if he had no facility for sex. There are other ways of doing it, and he is saying here on the screen also. so long as the body is in fine fettle, aam hai jism go ke nahi kus ghanimat arz. And in Budhape Ka Ishq, the poet explains the desire for love and sex continues in old age also. Very shortly, karte hain is budhape mein khuban ki hum to chaah, karte hain is budhape mein khuban ki hum to chaah, ahmaq hai khubroo jo wo haste hain hum pe aah. Ki ye budha kahan line maar raha hai, ahmaq hai khubroo jo wo haste hain hum pe aah, aur wo jo kuch shaur se rakhte hain dastgah, वो जो कुछ शऊर से रखते हैं दस्तगाह, सो वो तो हमको देख ये कहते हैं वाह वाह. And there are some other very interesting stuff here, but I'm skipping and now I'm coming towards conclusion, concluding part of my presentation. Less it all sounds pornographic. Nazir Akbar Abadi's oeuvre, you know, genre range is vast. We began with Holi, Diwali, festive blast and extravaganza of Muslim festivals such as Eid, to move into the intricacies of bodily and other features and their celebrations in the poet's work. This was part of the established tradition in popular Urdu literature to speak about matters of love and sex at a variety of registers, which could be explicit, it could be in double entendre, or in a more sophisticated language of love and longing, such as ghazal. Yet what Nazir has done is phenomenal. Unlike Hindi Riti poetry, which was largely meant for a courtly audience, Nazir encompasses a much more eclectic audience, and his language is also so very accessible. The vernacularization and democratization of language itself, particularly in expressing the erotic, which was again earlier meant largely for the elite, is equally significant. This part of the presentation, I'm just drawing from my conversation with my colleague who works on gender literature history, Professor Charu Gupta of the History Department. Generally, historians work separately on body and sexuality, or body and spirituality. So body and spirituality is one thing, body and sexuality is something else. But some people have to understand that spirituality and sexuality and body can go together. Whereas boundaries are especially marked in contexts where sexuality is taboo and spirituality recommended. In a significant work on two important Urdu literary figures, can I take 10 more minutes to finish this, or shall I finish now?
So we have around 5-10 minutes, so you can continue.
10 minutes, okay, yeah. So, because this is very interesting stuff coming up for further comparison from the same period and two poets. And the poetry is both full of emotions as also pain and other feelings expressed in ghazal. So Urdu literary figures, two important Urdu literary figures, contemporaneous with Nazir, but located in Deccan. One is in Aurangabad, Deccan, another is in Hyderabad. Scott Kugel has explicitly mixed it up for an interesting blend of gender, sexuality, and spirituality through two divans of two poets. Some people will be embarrassed and some will happily embrace it. Working on the lives and works of Shah Siraj of Aurangabad, who lived between 1715 and 1763, the period, you know, overlapping with Nazir's, and Mehlaqa Bai Chanda, female Sufi, you know, poet. Mehlaqa Bai Chanda of Hyderabad, 1768 and 1824. So within the period of Nazir once again, together Siraj and Mehlaqa Bai are identified as sun and moon respectively. And Kugel has offered a fascinating discussion of Urdu literary and cultural milieu of 18th and early decades of the 19th century Deccan, using the two characters and their divans. Who were these people? Outgrowing homosexual love in youth, Siraj Aurangabadi styled himself as a Sunni Sufi-like poet. On the other hand, rising above the filth around the life of a courtesan, Mehlaqa Bai Chanda, literally moon cheat, composed an elegant Urdu divan of her own. Remember, late 18th century, early 19th century, you know, a tawaif turned Sufi poet is writing a divan of her poetry, full collection of poetry. Once again, anchoring herself in Sufi spirituality, revealing a disarming devotion as a noon Sayyid. She was a Sayyid and Shi'i Muslim for Prophet Muhammad's son and cousin and son-in-law, Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib. She was devoted to, you know, Imam Ali. Specializing in ghazal compositions, both the poets Siraj and Mahlakabai fused the spiritual quest with erotic imagery for tantalizing results. Spiritual and erotic. Their Urdu Diwan should be a veritable treat for the connoisseur. As an accomplished scholar of bodily practices in Sufism and Dakni Urdu literature, Scott Kugel has first treated the two poets, Sun and Moon, separately as two orbits of the cultural planet. The author eventually brings them together in a literary conjunction when Sun meets Moon. And a couple of quick examples from their poetry I will give and conclude with that in another page. Kugel has provided English translations of a number of verses, the original Urdu of which is a veritable treat for the sheer linguistic charm of it. A couple of interesting lines quoted by the author may be mentioned here, and Siraj Aurangabadi points out in Urdu, somewhat Dakni style, but is proper Urdu of the 18th century. Sharabe shauq peekar do jahan ka jisne gham bhula. Sharabe shauq peekar do jahan ka jisne gham bhula. Khayale khame aflatuno fikre jame jam bhula. Khayale khame aflatuno fikre jame jam bhula. Meaning, forget theology and philosophy. Just relish the nectar of love. You know? Relish the nectar of love. Aflatun ki philosophy rahne dijiye. Mahlaka Bai Chanda also sings using the commonly deployed metaphor in Urdu poet, Persian poetry of intoxicating wine. You know, so wine is an important metaphor. And look at this poem, sher, couplet. Bahut makhmoor hoon, khumar hai. Bahut makhmoor hoon, saqi sharabe arghwani de. Bahut makhmoor hoon saqi sharabe arghwani de. Narak tishna mujhe saagar berahe meherbani de. Narak tishna mujhe saagar berahe meherbani de. And Mahlaka also complains about the emotional pangs and feelings of frustration which lovers have to usually endure, especially the tantrums of the beloved, who is still testing the depth of commitment, you know. When the beloved is still not, you know, convinced that the men, people who are claiming, you know, are actually truly committed. So the what will the lover say? Har roz jo yun sitam ijaab karoge, har roz jo yun sitam ijaab karoge, dil aashiqon ke saikdon barbaad karoge, dil aashiqon ke saikdon barbaad karoge. And therefore, it would appear for Hyderabad friends, it must have been a truly cosmopolitan city in the 18th century, with a vibrant cultural and intellectual movement in the 18th, early 19th centuries. For another female poet with a well-known Urdu Diwan to her credit, another lady, another poet, woman, Lutfun Nisa Imtiaz. So her name is, pen name is Imtiaz, so people would think that she might be him, man, but it was Lutfun Nisa. She was a contemporary of Mahlaka Bai Chanda, and has composed a divan, and someone should read and analyze that. Indeed, historians are now increasingly reading the vast corpus of Urdu poetry to discover a whole cultural world that was previously outside their narrow frame. However, they are still not equipped to make sense of powerful poetic imagery and refined expression of overwhelming emotions. And several of these lines by Siraj Aurangabadi, with which I'm finishing this Deccan part. Aina ruke shauk mein hairan hua hu main, aina ruke shauk mein hairan hua hu main, zulfon ko uski dekh pareshan hua hu main, zulfon ko uski dekh pareshan hua hu main. And thus Urdu poetry cannot be dismissed as vulgar expressions catering to the low class taste of people of a decadent society, which is what they say for Jafar Zayd Ali and Azir Akbar Abadi. The poets could be highly imaginative, indeed philosophical, with an understanding of both the material and spiritual worlds that could inspire awe in the eyes of the contemporaries. They also offered powerful critique and dissent against the flawed normativities of their time. The poet also celebrated the best of the bounties of nature, wrote tributes for their patrons, expressed devotion for popular religious figures, and more often than not, poured out love for their motherland, country, city. Besides matters of bazaar, festivities, and fun, Nazir's devotional poetry dedicated to the extraordinary powers of religious gurus is equally enchanting. This is the last couplet I'm reciting, and then I will stop. This is about Guru Nanak, and it is fascinating. Two couplets, and then I'm into concluding page now. Listen to this. Hey, kahte Nanak Shah jine wo pure hai agah guru. Hey, kahte Nanak Shah jine wo pure hai agah guru. Wo kamil rehbar jag mein hai yun roshan jaise mahe guru. मकसूद मुराद उम्मीद सभी बर लाते हैं दिलखा गुरु नित लुत्फो करम से करते हैं हम लोगों का निर्वाह गुरु इस बख्शिश के इस अजमत के हैं बाबा नानक शाह गुरु सब शीश निवार अरदास करो और हरदम बोलो वाहे गुरु हर आम दिलों बीच यहाँ अपने जो ध्यान गुरु का लाते हैं और सेवक होकर उनके ही हर सूरत बीच कहते हैं अगर अपनी लुत्फ इनायत से सुख चैन उन्हें दिखलाते हैं खुश रखते हैं हर हाल उन्हें सब तन का काज बनाते हैं इस बख्शिश के इस अजमत के हैं बाबा नानक शाह गुरु सब शीश निवा अरदास करो और हरदम बोलो वाहे गुरु जो लुत्फ इनायत उनमें है कब वसफ किसी से उनका हो वो लुत्फ करम जो करते हैं हर चार तरफ है जाहिर वो अल्ताफ जिनों पर है उनके सो खूबी हासिल है उनको हर आम नजीर अब यहाँ तुम भी बाबा नानक शाह कहो सब शीश नवा अरदास करो और हर दम बोलो वाहे गुरु आई एम स्टॉपिंग नाउ वाज जस्ट ब्रीफ कंक्लूजन एंड 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 वी बिगिन टू टेक सम क्वेश्चंस इफ इफ वी कैन कंटिन्यू सो इन कंक्लूजन स्कॉलर्स आर इंक्रीजिंगली रियलाइजिंग that literature and history are inextricably linked to each other. Earlier literary scholars had generally no or little sense of history. They doubted what historians do, and poorly trained academic historians thought literature is all about fictitious imagination of writers, devoid of any sense of reality. So therefore, the two could not talk. Historians are now beginning to realize that the government data which is so much valued for the writing of history, which could be fudged. As it happens to cover up failures of governance. So why should we depend on government data all the time? By contrast, all literatures are products of their time. Literature and society construct each other. Historians can study literature to understand its context, which is what the parameters of research recommend. Understand the past in all its varied dimensions, including literary cultures and intellectual traditions, to understand a society better. Here, our focus was on highlighting the value of the intersection between literature, history, and society, especially on matters of pleasure. For this purpose, we discussed samples of Nazir Akbarabadi's exceptional work, contextualized and understood with reference to the larger Urdu field, the classical Urdu literature of the 18th and first half of the 19th centuries. Some efforts were made, therefore, through examples of a literary tradition shared with equally important figures such as Jafar Zatali, Mir Taqi Mir, and Mirza Ghalib, and the two Dakni figures, Siraj Aurangabadi and Mahalakabai Chanda, among others. It is a scintillating chapter in India's checkered cultural history, which needs more research into its many wonderful dimensions, including momentary celebration of life and dealing with the lasting pain of death. Nazir himself concludes in his philosophical observations on life in this popular line, which all of you have surely heard. Sab thaat pada reh jayega jab laad chalega banjara. Sab thaat pada reh jayega jab laad chalega banjara. Thank you, I'm stopping now.
Thank you very much, Professor Akhil, for delivering this lecture. Very interesting and I think rather less explored territory of Nazir Akhilwadi's poetry. And as you said, the intersection, conjunction between literature and sexuality and body in such way. So we have many questions for you in the and we'll take some questions out of those. The first question is from Professor Amit Day. Question is, will it be justified to argue that the continuous flow of Shia into South Asia largely contributed to the redefinition of pleasure in this part of the world?
Please repeat the question again.
Will it be justified to argue that the continuous flow of Shia elite into South Asia largely contributed to the redefinition?
Continuous flow of
Shia elite.
No, I don't think we can frame this question like this. But this is true that some of the finest poets that we are talking about have Shia antecedents, but they had wide popularity, in among Muslims across firqas and sects, etc. These poets themselves transcended. Nazir would never claim that I'm a Shia and therefore I'm speaking in this manner, or Ghalib would never say that I'm a Shia and therefore I speak like this, you know. And this Shia-Sunni chakkar is not good, and many people understand it. And the best of the people have transcended whatever happened in Karbala, whatever happened with the Ahle Bayt, you know, which is unfortunate chapter in Islamic history. But, you know, I mean, if you look at Sufi poetry, and some of these are coming from very, very heavy influence of Sufism in their writings. So Shia Sunni distinctions will not hold beyond a point. You know, I will say. But yes, some fine poetry are actually composed by Marcia Nigari, like Shahri Ashur. Marcia Nigari is very, very touching, very, 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 very emotional. And therefore, I don't see much, I don't look at the Muslim cultural traditions within those sectarian boxes, because the poets themselves, defied all those boxes.
The next question is from Mirza Hassan, and his question, what was erotic poem genre always present to literary history?
Please repeat the question again.
Was erotic poem genre always present in Urdu literary history?
Erotic. You see, this is one genre. Erotic is one genre. Shahr-e-Ashub is another genre. Qasida is another. You know, double entendre, when you cannot say explicitly, erotically, double entendre, in a language that has double meanings, etc. So there are different genres. Maybe erotic is certainly an important component of it, but not all poets are expressing themselves in crudely erotic ways. But it is an important, very, very important genre. When we write a history of Urdu literature, literary cultures, literary practices, Urdu from the 18th century, 19th, 20th century, eroticism will certainly be there. This is the period, 18th, 19th, 20th century, that we are dealing here, especially 18th and first half of the 19th century. Not all poets are writing at that register. Some could be very, very crude. Some were very, in Moti. And Moti, there is nothing sexual about it, and yet it is so very interesting in terms of the description of mannerism and as also body parts. So therefore, or Samdhan, for instance, is more. So there are different registers and levels, language, or sometimes euphemism that would be deployed by poets. Let me also explain that I am not a literary scholar of Urdu poetry, that I would be offering literary critiques and the history of literary criticism, etc. I am using this material from a context of the 18th century, knowing Nazir is a historical figure, as Mir Taqi Mir is, or was, or Ghalib was, and what exactly are they saying, in what context, and through which we can understand. Because 18th century literature is for the 18th century context. You know, 13th century literature will be for 13th century context. Similarly, 21st century literature will be 21st century context. And therefore, so Nazir cannot be produced now in the 21st century, or, you know, or someone asked about Sufis, you know, Shia tradition. You know, there are different contexts in which those literary figures emerged and composed what they did. But yes, erotic poetry is very, very interesting. It's a large purpose, you know, and we have to take cognizance of that.
The next question is by Arjun Abhishek Roy, and it's a long question. His question is, Persian language dominated Mughal literature and post-Mughal era. Urdu came later. Other regional literary practices came up. Especially Vaishnava literature were famous for love and erotic poems. So was Urdu literature drew influence from the Vaishnava literary traditions?
No, I don't think we can speak like this. We will say that there is a vernacular field, you know, of the 16th century, 17th century, 18th century, which comes all the way to the modern times, the 19th, 20th century. And there was a classical field of the Sanskrit and, you know, Persian here. So certainly it will start with Sanskrit in a big way, you know, literary, you know, domain. And from 16th century, we are seeing that, you know, Sanskrit texts are being translated into Braj. And we also see at the same time, you know, Alison Bush, if you heard my lecture, as mentioned, you know, the classical period of Hindi literature is the Mughal period. So much as the significance of and power of Persian is emphasized at the Mughal court in Mughal official idioms, farmans, etc., the language of the court, language of the bazaar in Agra and Mathura is not Persian, it is Hindi. You know, and there are registers of Hindi, you know, so there are different registers of Hindi. So Tulsidas has a register of Hindi, Abdul Rahim Khane Khana will have a register of Hindi. Before that, Kabir will have a register of Hindi, you know. And Urdu emerges in a big way in the 18th century, early 18th century in North India, but in Deccan is already in the 16th, 17th century is a Urdu, Dakhni, you know, Dakhni Urdu. It's a huge field. Mm-hmm. Already, so there are multiple influences, and you know, biggest, you know, genealogies and heritage, and you know, larger fields, literary milieu, where people are appropriating. As I said, head to toe description goes back to ancient times, and it is being used in such wonderful language, etc. So I would say that this is an old assumption about Persian. Certainly, you know, Persian is very, very important, as English today is. You know, our mother tongue is not English, but I'm speaking in English for the last, 1.5 hours. You know, this lecture is in English, and we are not doing it in Hindi here in Delhi. So Persian similarly was the language, official language, but the language of the bazaar, language of people, language of informal conversations would not always be Sanskrit in ancient times and Persian in medieval times and English in modern times. Once the lecture is over, we start speaking in Hindi. We don't speak English in our, English is not our mother tongue. Hum log angrez ki aulad nahi hai. So Indians are not Farsi nazar. Farsi seekhna pad raha tha, people learned Persian, but Hindustan, before the divide into Urdu and Hindi in the late 19th century, will be a vast Hindustani field, and people will understand this language. And therefore, there'll be other vernacular fields in Eastern India, in Southern India, you know, wherever we go, we have vernaculars. And these are very, very culturally embedded vernaculars, and with their own literary tradition, with their own historical traditions, and it's linked to their identities, you know, in political context in 16th, 17th century, as in the 20th century and 21st.
This next question is by Professor Amit Bey again, and his question is, did the Sufi literati ever try to reconcile the concept of pleasure with the notion of akhlaq?
Sufi literature with notion of akhlaq, what is akhlaq? So there are adab, certainly, norms, and norms of comportment. And there are also, therefore, recommendations that there are certain things which are private to Sufi practices, and there are certain expressions that can be become public also. So therefore, poetry, you know, of the kind that was used in Mahfil-e-Sama, you know, musical assemblies, you know, of ghazal variety, would be understandable to people, or those who can understand and have a zauq, you know, and taste and exposure to that kind of thing. And then there are practices which are not to be shared in public, you know, expressions are to be kept private. So this private and public distinction was, and that's what you know, is being recommended with experience of Mansoor Hallaj, that your private experience about you know, having witnessed God and feeling of being God and merging in God, etc., was your personal experience. You can't go to bazaar and roads and streets and start talking about I have seen God and, you know, I was merged in myself, you know, I was merged in God and therefore I become God, etc. So therefore, there are adabs, you know, and also akhlaq in conducts, you know, personal conduct, manners and comportments. This is what I yeah, I understand.
The next question is by Arjun Abhishek Roy again, and his question is, it is highly interesting to know that homosexual love and erotic poems were written in Urdu literature. How were those received by the readers, the homosexual love and erotic poems? If you can give us a little detail on that.
You see, this is a Facebook live and people are listening, all kinds of people. So I don't know how much, what is the limit of our speaking here in details, but you know, for this audience, within this audience and our conversation, because it's there in the literature, you know, londabazi was all right. A Mughal prince can be a londabaz. So to have an affair with a londa is an example of manliness, that the man has a londa, you know, that londa can be, you know, can be used for whatever purpose. The Mughal prince, therefore, can be a londabaz. You remember, Babur and Humayun could be expressing their, you know, love for, you know, boys. But as the Mughal state established itself in terms of patriarchal, masculine, and with harem having many women in, you know, secluded there, that no longer from Akbar's time they would talk about how they can fall for a chikna boy, you know, a londa. So londabazi could still be all right in the 17th century and the 18th century. But if a Mughal prince is identified as a gandu, as a catamite, as a passive recipient of sex from the other person, so in a subordinated position of the gandu, that is not acceptable. As in this satire by Jafar Zatalli on Bahadur Shah, you know, that is not acceptable. So there is this distinction. And then there are other categories also, you know, we say ABCD kind of category, but this distinction is very, 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 very clear. Londabazi is okay, you know, Gandugiri not, you know, it is very, very explicit in the literature. Many examples can be given, which would also mean homosexual love is not recommended in society. Homosexual love is being condemned, and it is condemned precisely because it exists in society. You know, something is being condemned precisely because it exists, and therefore homosexual love existed and there were condemnation of it, and therefore to an extent passive control of the male body, you know, by a londabaz is allowed, and when someone who is a recipient of that, you know, dominance, male dominance on a male body, so it is not, you know, adult, mutually consented male to male, you know, homosexual male love. It could be exploitation, sexual exploitation. You know, an old man is eyeing for a boy. The boy who is still a chikna boy, in the sense, uske daadhi aur moch nahi niklegi. So, you know. So that kind of proposition. But as soon as that boy, you know, grows up, would understand that this old man was exploiting him. So we'll move on. It is also possible that man, that boy who becomes a man, can go on to do the same thing with other boys. You know, so he can also become a Londabas. So there are references, many references to this kind of material and experiences and fascinations. Homosexual, sometimes homoerotic. So homoerotic means, you know, fascination, but not involving sex, you know. So that distinction is also very much there, homoerotic and homosexual.
We will take one last question for the evening. And this is again by Professor Day, and his question is, do you think that the metaphorical use of wine was mainly inspired by Umar Khayyam's Rubaiyat?
I don't know about this. Maybe those people who have done some research, they will answer better. But this is not my topic here also. And I don't know actually about this.
So thank you so much, sir, for answering all the queries that we had on the Facebook chat and for delivering such an interesting and unique topic to all of us this evening. It was truly an honor to host you, and we look forward to having you again very soon.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, everybody who joined us live this evening. This lecture will be available on YouTube very soon, so you can share it with your friends, family, and everybody who you know who will be interested in many more lectures like these that are available on Carva. Don't forget to subscribe to Carvan and share it with your friends. Thank you, and have a great day ahead.